So welcome back. Let's talk a little bit about how things can go wrong. Everything I've shown you so far is syntactically correct, but rest assured, as you start writing code, you're going to make various syntax errors. And there's a whole bunch of little error handling options that PDO has that we can play with. And so here is a bit of code. It's kind of like we're just doing this select. We're going to read a user. Select star from users where user ID equals whatever, and we're going to do a fetch. We're looking at how things go wrong. We're either going to say the user is not found or is found. And so, you know, this is the default error mode warning. I'll talk about those in a second. And so this is going to work because this is the placeholder, and this is the placeholder, and there's a user ID. And whether it finds the user or not, it's not whether the user, the first thing to say is, if you do a select and you don't get a record, as long as the select is syntactically correct, then that's not actually an error. That's okay, you just get no row, and in this case you get a false row, versus a syntax error, like if you make a syntax error. So an example of a syntax error with this code right here is if, for example, I basically in my code I say colon XYZ, and then in my little array I say colon pizza. You will, at this point, it will blow up. It'll say, whoa, you don't have the right thing. It's not going to work. And so I couldn't find a thing that maps pizza properly. So it doesn't. And so that is the kind of error that we're going to run into, a kind of a blow-up error. It's like a syntax error. It's like an SQL syntax error. And so if you look and you look at the documentation, there is a couple of different things. And the problem is that you can have it say, don't say anything, don't do any error messages whatsoever. You can say, put out a warning and keep going. And the one I prefer and the one I set up all the time is what's called error mode exception, which means blow up right then and there, tell me what line of code is wrong and quit. So that's why a couple of slides back, I did that. And so if you run this code with this mistake in it, this XYZ and pizza not matching, it'll complain. And then it'll just keep on going, right? It'll just keep on going. It's blowing up here in execute. Yeah, it's blowing up here, but it keeps on going. And that's kind of not what you want. That's not what you want. If you say exception, then it stops. And so it comes in here. We set this attribute, so make it be exception. And then we make the same mistake, and it blows up here, and it says, oh, uncaught exception, blah, 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 blah. But what's important is it stops. It stops running the code so that you can actually, it's dangerous to keep on running this code because you don't know if that was supposed to do something or if it's going to have an unintended consequence. So this is the way that I like it a lot. I like to keep it that way. And you'll notice that, so if you set exception, you can actually do exception processing by enclosing the whole thing in a try-catch block, right? So you can have a try, and then you can have a catch, and that'll gives you some data about the exception. So either it runs and it works and it goes, or it runs, blows up, and then runs the catch block. So once you do exception, if you want to catch it. But the interesting thing is that, well, you can do this and print out your own message, basically, and so you have some control over it, and that message now is coming out of my catch block right there. And so it's not bad, but generally you really want to quit, and you see how it says return here, it give up, it just stopped, and that's a way, quit or exit, return or exit, because you sort of want to print the message out, and this way you're controlling what the message looks like, but you're not continuing on, because if this didn't work, and it's like a syntax error. It's like you made a mistake. I mean, this is a mistake. It wasn't bad data, or it wasn't missing data. That's normal. That's not going to cause an exception. You cause an exception because you kind of have like a typographical error in your code. Okay? So that's why you either use error mode exception and let it just blow up like it does here with a traceback, or do your own try catch and print a message out under your own control. The nice thing about this, well, both of them are going to log stuff, and you might have to actually add here an error log so you can catch it later, because that's the next thing we're going to talk about is how error logs work. And so every time there's an error in your PHP, like what I told you to fix in display errors early on, so you just say display errors on. If display errors is off, the errors go into a log, just not to the screen. And the reason I tell you to put display errors on is it's hard to find the log. So now we're going to find the log. It's nice to look at the log, and when everything is going wrong, I mean, I still do this. Like, what is going wrong? And the other thing that's nice about the log is even if it's not you that's using your application, if someone else is using your application, you still can read the log. So on a production system, you can read the log. How do you find where the error logs are? They're just files on the server system. In the case of your data, of your desktop or your laptop, it's a file that's on your laptop. So go to PHP Info. However you go, find it in MAMP, you know, click on PHP Info, or XAMPP has its own place, or write a little script that prints out PHP Info yourself. Whatever it is, the location of the error log is just another configured value. And so this says, for my particular thing, it's in the folder Applications, MAMP, Logs, and it's called the file phperrorlog.php. So you can find your way to the error log, whether it's MAMP or XAMPP or var log something 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 on Linux. You can open that file, and some text editors will notice as the file gets appended to and then give you the additional information. In Mac and Linux, there's this really cool command called tail, which just sits at the end of the file and just prints out the new things that come on. It just waits until the file gets extended and then prints that stuff out from you. And you can get like a tail command for Windows. Mac also has this thing called the console that can tail these things, but I tend to use command line and tail because then I can see it. And this is kind of what it looks like if you're tailing that log. You could just open the log in a text editor, but you might have to reopen it to see the new files because it just adds to the end. And so this is what it looks like, and I'm using, on my Macintosh, I am using a tail command, tail minus F, and minus F says, show me the end of the file, but don't stop and keep showing me new things that get added to the file. So it just sits there, goes blurp, 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 and new little lines come out. And all of this, all these little mistakes, whether it's a syntax error, these are just all these errors that are happening as I'm writing code and I'm making mistakes in writing code. And, you know, here's this error too, right? It shows that this thing was it was thrown. It shows you the line of code, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so these error logs are super useful, especially when you're in production and there's like users all over that are using your application and they're causing errors. And so you want to watch those logs roll by and make sure that you see the errors. I actually have little scripts that read the log every day and send me email for anomalies in production systems. And that's so that I know when you're using one of my production systems and you start seeing error messages, actually 15 minutes later, I start seeing them on email. They show right up on my phone. So I get to see them. So I have a little script that reads these, and then anything new gets sent to my phone. And professional companies have that monitoring figured out. So this was a super cool lecture. I mean, I'm really excited that you made it this far. We basically have shown how to make a database connection. I mean, it's like only three lines of code to make a database connection and send some data, send a SQL command, and then pull some data back, right? There's some fancier bits to it, prepared statements and these substitution parameters. We talked a little bit about SQL injection, why you don't want to do that, what can go wrong there. And as long as you use PDO and prepared statements for everything that ever comes for a user, then you'll be fine. And then we took a look at about how errors tend to happen. So thanks for taking the time to listen. Cheers. See you on the net.